Are you using the right protection or are you being burned? Find out how using this may be a false hope and setting yourself up for cancer unknowingly. You don't want to miss this episode, so stay tuned.
Is your sunscreen doing more harm than good? Scientists speculate that free radicals produced in skin when sunscreen chemicals break down in sunlight may promote cell damage and contribute to skin damage and cancer. And this has led to some confusion on whether sunscreen can avert melanoma, the deadliest form of cancer.
Wow, that's incredible. And a recent FDA study indicates that a form of vitamin A known as retinopalmate, when applied to the skin in the presence of sunlight, may speed the development of skin tumors and lesions. And here's the shocking truth and sad part of it about this, Keith, is that scientists have known for some time that vitamin A can spur excess skin growth and that in the sunlight it can cause free radical damage to the DNA.
And that's, you know, he said scientists, they know exactly what they're doing. Because here's another shocking truth. The FDA is not aware of data demonstrating that sunscreen use alone can prevent skin cancer.
That's incredible. I can't believe that.
So what can we do to protect ourselves?
That is a great question. And to answer this, I caught up with Marguerite Mullins, owner of Scottsdale Skin Rejuvenation, who specializes in anti-aging and skincare. Keith, watch this. Hey Keith, guess what? I am here with Marguerite Mullins, owner of Scottsdale Skin Rejuvenation. So welcome and thank you so much for taking some time out of your busy schedule to answer our questions.
Thank you.
And I know Keith is really wanting to know what SPF is and we'll get to that, okay? But the first question I have is, as you know, the FDA has new sunscreen regulations coming out. However, they're not taking any indication or taking into account any of the concerns with the serious toxic ingredients such as hormone and endocrine disruptors and those that are known to cause cancer. So what's your take on this?
It's true. Oftentimes cosmetics are compromised by adding ingredients into them to make them more aesthetically appealing to the consumers. Mm-hmm. And just because it says, the marketing on the bottle says that it's good for your skin and healthy doesn't necessarily make it so. Consumers really need to study up on those ingredients in their products because what you put on your skin is going to end up in your bloodstream and will affect your well-being.
Yeah, absolutely. I know that for sure. So how can we protect ourselves and not take in all of these chemicals and toxins?
Good question.
Thank you.
Well, there's two different types of sunblocks out there. There's a physical sunblock and there's a chemical sunblock. A physical sunblock sits on top of your skin and it reflects the UV rays from penetrating into the skin. These type of sunblocks have ingredients such as zinc oxide in them and titanium dioxide. Mm-hmm. A chemical sunscreen does allow the rays to penetrate into the skin and neutralizes them after penetration. My personal preference would be the physical sunblock because why let those UV rays into the skin to have any opportunity to cause damage to the skin?
Sure, absolutely. All right, so this is Keith's question, and you know what the sad part is? I'm going to ask this, and I guarantee you he's going to ask it again. What is SPF and what numbers do you recommend that we should be wearing?
Well, SPF stands for sun protection factor, and the easiest way to think about it is, for example, take somebody who would typically burn in the sun in 10 minutes without any sunblock on.
Okay.
But if you put an SPF of 15 on that person, rather than burning in 10 minutes, they'll burn in 150 minutes. So the burn time is it's multiplied by 15. They can go 15 times longer without burning.
Interesting. I didn't even know that. Wow.
A lot of people don't know that.
No, I had no idea. I just figured it was some technical term, and it's something relatively easy.
Yeah.
Oh.
So what I recommend is a person who's, you know, just going from the grocery store into their car, you know, pretty minimal sun exposure, I recommend an SPF of 15. Somebody who's going to the beach or going on a long hike, they might want to try something a bit higher, like SPF of 30 or maybe 50. That's kind of for a person who's they don't remember to reapply it.
Sure.
So it's going to be less of a hassle to have to keep reapplying.
Okay, well, let's talk about like an all-natural approach to sunscreen. Say someone like me, for instance, I'm always in the car, I'm always out and about, and I don't really need a sunscreen, and I'm not really into sunscreen. So, and I also don't want to be putting all those chemicals on my skin. So what can I do that's really natural?
Good question. So somebody who's really concerned about taking the all-natural approach, I recommend, there's different types of oils and plants out there that do have natural sunblocks in them,
really?
Such as coconut oil. Coconut oil has been used for many years by people in the tropics to help keep their skin healthy and looking good. Coconut oil has a natural SPF in it of around 7, so that's definitely a good one to try for those type of people.
I had no idea. That's really interesting. Well, Marguerite, I appreciate it so much that you could take some time out of your busy schedule to be with us. Keith, back to you.
Well, there's one thing I just want to bring back. You see me on here as a black man, and we also do, I found out that I can burn also as far as when it comes to sun, because I've gone out and I do things in jet ski and so forth, and I did find out that my skin was peeling because I didn't use sunscreen, any type of sunscreen.
Anybody can burn, Keith. It's just, you can stay out there and base longer than I can. I go out there, actually, I'm so white, Keith, that my friends all get tans because of the reflection on their skin.
FDA is making changes to how sunscreen are marketed in the United States, and the final rule take effect this summer.
Mm-hmm.
But keep in mind, it is mainly for protection of UVB and UVA radiation from the sun.
Yeah, so you know what? It's that old, buyer beware. You really need to take a good look at the ingredient list and understand what you are putting in your body. Although the FDA is coming out with new rulings, and it'll probably be this week, if anything, they are not interested in the potential harming form endocrine or hormone disrupting ingredients that most sunscreens use. So for extended periods out in the sun, I actually like this one, Keith. It's Elba. It's non-greasy, it has no parabens in it, and none of that vitamin A that we were talking about as well. And I love this part, and I feel, just like right on the money there, Keith, because I use coconut oil. I've been using coconut oil for years. I keep it in a little small glass jar. And in the summertime, I add wintergreen or peppermint oil to it because when the wind hits it, it's like cooling. So it kind of cools the skin down. And I also use lavender because lavender helps protect from the sun as well. So I feel like I've got one up. So thanks to Marguerite for that little tip.
No, Marguerite, she did speak about a few things. I like that. That says green tea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, green tea is also very protecting as well. Yes, it will help with the antioxidants. But I think, even though there is some green tea in here, I also think that you also need to drink green tea for the antioxidant benefits. But yeah, no, definitely. I love this one. It's great.
Okay, yeah. Marguerite, she gave some great information on that.
Mm-hmm.
So now let's go ahead and move on to this week's Wellness Beat Move It Tip with Jolene Goring, Fitness Director of GeoFit Personal Training.
Watch this.
Hey, Keith and Karen. One of the best parts about summer is that we get to show off our shoulders and our arms all summer long. Here's a quick exercise you can do to keep your shoulders looking beautiful. All you have to do is keep your arms out at 90 degrees and do little arm circles. Do a minute forward and then a minute backwards. Repeat that 3 times. Do that a couple times a week and your shoulders will look beautiful all summer long.
Awesome movie tip. Hopefully she has her all-natural sunscreen on as well. Now it's time to, what it is.
Yes, I do.
On the menu.
It's on the menu. Watch this. You're going to love it. Hey, Keith. Since you love hamburgers so much, I thought I would share a great recipe with you. But guess what? We're not using hamburger. We're using bison. So we are making either buffalo burgers or bison burgers, whatever you want to call them. So we are starting with a pound of bison, and we are going to add in 2 cloves of garlic and half a small onion or, a couple of shallots, that kind of thing, and just mince them. And you just want to throw them right into the bowl. And here is my secret. You're going to get yourself an organic salsa,
and you're just gonna dump that in. It's about a quarter cup. You can go a little more or a little less depending on your fancy. And this is Karen's ultimate secret, okay? It's not the rosemary that's on top, which is about 2 tablespoons. It is the cumin underneath. Oh yeah, baby. And then on the bottom, and there's about 2 tablespoons of that, and then on the bottom of that, we have 2 tablespoons of chili powder. So in it goes. And this is the kind of recipe where you get your hands all nice and kind of dirty. You're just gonna get in there and you're gonna start mixing it all up. Then all you have to do once everything is all nice and mixed in, just look at that yummy loveliness. You're just gonna take a handful and you're just gonna round it out like so and put it on the plate. And then we're just gonna do that with the rest of it, and then we're gonna go pop it on the barbecue.
All right, so now our burgers are ready to go on to the well-heated barbecue. And then Keith, we're gonna leave these on for about 10 to 12 minutes, give them a good flip over, and they'll be ready to go. All right, Keith, there you have it. You've got luscious, succulent looking bison burgers. Now the trick to bison burgers, you just wanna undercook it a little bit so that it doesn't become hard, tough, and gamey. Then of course, you just wanna pair it up with a little bit of salad. And you can see here that you can have it normal, which is, you know, on a bun. But for our gluten intolerant or celiac viewers, you can either just, you know, put it on a bed of lettuce and just cut the hamburger in half. Oh my goodness, hamburger. Bison burger in half. Or what we do in our household is we actually take cabbage because it makes like a really nice little cup. And then we just cover it up like so. And there you go. You have a wonderful gluten-free, healthy burger.
Woo! You know what? That was such a great recipe. I think I'm going to get it as well. What do you think?
Oh, yes.
And you know what else is on there? Oh, you've got it pulled up. You've got Jolene on there with her Move It tip. That's
awesome. It's one of my favorites.
Woohoo! I'm sure it is. I'm sure it is. She's hot, right? Well, we hope you enjoyed this week's show. Be sure to tweet, pin, share, like, and comment below. And until next week,
see ya!